All right, folks, God bless you guys, and welcome to This Is It, 4321, Before the Fire. All right, guys, well, let's do something very different today, huh? I'm sick of all the drama. Are y'all sick and tired of all the drama? Can you believe the craziness that's been involved in the past, whatever, it's been a couple weeks now? It's insane. Lies, deceit, setups, all kinds of craziness. Anyway, I've got what I need now. I've got the information I need put in separate places, put in different places. There's a lot of information that has not been made public yet, and we're not going to yet, because there's certain avenues that public, that information is set to go in the event of certain criteria or certain things happening, that the information will find its way where it needs to be. Anyway, so, but you don't give them all your stuff. No. You give them enough to let them know what you got to make things obvious. I think things are pretty obvious now, aren't they? Okay, so we'll just put that on the visor for a little while. Now let's get back to what we do. Let's expose this whole serpent race thing. I think that's critical for people to understand just how important it is to understand that the Vatican is a snake wearing a crown. What in the world would a building be doing being built in the shape of a snake wearing a crown? Why is a snake eating angels? I mean, isn't that like, does that not blow your mind? Shouldn't the whole world know? Wait a minute. If you think you're going into the snake to worship God, if you're walking in the door to the Vatican, what, you think you're going in there to worship Jesus? No, that's something else going on. You're walking inside of a building that's Satan. The serpent is Satan. Anyway, so I'm going to show you guys a bunch of sheep stuff tonight, because we're the sheep that were led to the slaughter. The serpent race was leading all of us to the slaughter. How? Well, by using the host body system, because we're angels and we get trapped inside of a host body with a demon. We're yoked together with a demon, and then that process, through the host body, your flesh destroys the angel that's inside the body. That's it. Who will save me from this body of death? Praise be to God, Christ Jesus. All right. So, do y'all know that you two opened up at the Sphere, right? I know some of you, oh, you two, they're bad. Okay, all right. Y'all understand that the word resurrection means the standing up again. Well, why? Because we were in a position where we weren't standing up. The host body is the thing that destroys the angel. It's the mechanism that destroys the angel. And in Ezekiel, we know that Lucifer sits in the seat of Elohim. And the word sits in the seat of Elohim means he sits, he's in the center of you, in the population of humanity. So why do you think you have to be converted? Why? Why would you have to be converted? Converted from what? Well, converted from this. You have an angel and a demon inside of you. You have your own Cain and Abel. Cain down, Abel up. You have your own light and dark. You have your own good and evil inside of you. That's what the whole mystery of everything is. And it's made manifest right in front of you all the time. Just when you're part of it, you just can't see it. You have to be converted in order to see it. You get converted and you're able to look at it and go, oh my God, what is going on? So let's just take a look at some of that stuff and look at just how obvious it is. And then apply all this knowledge even to the current situation that's going on. It's phenomenal to get to see what we're seeing. I believe we're at the edge of everything happening. I know that the YouTube video that came out, the very first video they did before they went into the sphere, they showed the rapture. I showed it to you in one of the last videos, one of the couple last videos. So anyway, let me pull some stuff up, and then I'm going to walk you through a folder that you need to go through yourself. You need to go through the entire folder just to see the supernatural data that's in this folder is more valuable than all the money in the world. I walked away from my other life where Jonathan Cleck, the wild man, when everybody loved me, you know, when I say everybody loved me, I was totally accepted by, it was Johnny, Harry, hey, Johnny. I was a pretty wild guy. I've made it no secret that before I got converted, I was a pretty wild guy. I think I had 21 arrests, no convictions. Yeah, but then on the thing I didn't do, I actually got a conviction, and it was after I got saved. I was like, wow, that's odd. It's interesting, though, but I became a new creation in Christ. You talk about an obvious change in some person. The Jonathan Cleck before was a pretty wild guy, and then after I got converted, well, I dedicated my life to helping others, serving Christ, and I have nothing since then. I won custody of all my kids in two different custody cases because allegations were being made against me that I was on drugs and I was crazy. And I'm like, well, wait a minute. Let's go in front of a judge, and went in front of the judge. And I said, that's a great idea. Let's do a psych eval. Let's do drug tests. I went and took mine right away. And this is all part of a public record. My opponent waited till the last day to take their drug test in one of the cases. The very last day, 45 days later. I went right away to take mine. And then I went and took my psych evaluation. I told you, court order psychologist, Dina Trevino. Called me up. I'll never forget it. She called me up. She's like, Jonathan, this is Dina Trevino. Would you please come into our office, my office? I've got your evaluation ready, and I'd like to talk to you about it. I was like, I hope it's good. So I went in and I saw her, and I'll never forget what she said. I sat down and I was anxious because, you know, I'd never been through something like that. And I sat down and she said, Jonathan, there's something that just doesn't make any sense to me. And I'm like, uh-oh, here we go. I wonder what that is. And she said, Jonathan, your psych evaluation comes out so just clean that we call it unremarkable in my field, my profession. We call it unremarkable. And I'm thinking, she goes, that means I don't even have a remark to make about your psych evaluation. I mean, there's nothing to talk about, nothing. It's unremarkable. I don't have a remark to make about it. So that's when I learned what the meaning unremarkable meant. I was like, oh, well, that's good. You know, yay. And she goes, yeah. And she goes, but the thing I don't understand, Jonathan, the thing I really just don't understand is why would your ex make these claims about you that are just don't fit with your testing at all? And I remember exactly what I said. I sat there and I looked at her and I went, that's a good question, isn't it? Maybe you should ask her. Well, as part of the court record that I had to go through, the judge had ordered me to take the psych evaluation when I think it was Judge John Birchelman. And when he told me I had to go take the psych evaluation, and I thought it was going to be for everybody. I was like, all right, you know, we're going to get down to the bottom of this. And I was like, but he told me I had to go take it, and he didn't court order her to go take it. And I was like, wait a minute. I was just like, that's not fair. But then after I took it, the court-ordered psychologist said, well, you test out so perfectly that what's going on? I said, well, that's a really good question, isn't it? She said, we need to get her in for some testing. And when she went in for the testing, you got to do your baseline. I think it's almost 1,000 questions, and they use that as your baseline. Then you go in. It took like maybe a month and a half, 2 months to take this thing. Then you go in at different dates and you got to take other tests, and they'll ask you the same questions in a different way. It's called an MMPI. Anyway, so I went in and mine was perfect. She said unremarkable. When I say perfect, the word is unremarkable. And then when the person making the very allegations against me that I was crazy, I was on drugs, all that stuff, when she went in to take it, she was taking the baseline and she just said, you know what, I'm not doing this. She got up and walked out, and Dina Trevino said, it's not optional. And she was, talk to my lawyer. I'm like, okay. And because of that, and because of a letter that had been stolen from me, that I had a copy of that they didn't know about. When we were in court and that letter was presented, and the reality that someone had walked out of a psych evaluation saying, I'm not doing it, but I did it. Unremarkable. Why don't you do it? I mean, that seems fair, doesn't it? That's what I went through. That's just a little sliver of what I went through. But anyway, so I've seen these kind of things where people make allegations that are just not true. But they're quick to judge. They're quick to call me a Satanist. A lot of these people are. But have you looked at the channel that they're at? The Gene Rebel channel is pure Satanist. All they do is accuse, attack, malign, and hate. Those are all satanic things. My channel, I'm showing you what's hidden in plain sight. The Bible says whatever makes manifest is light. Yes or no? Jesus is the light of the world. So when I show you the Vatican's a snake, do you think the darkness showed you that or the light? Did Jesus or did the Holy Spirit reveal through me that the Vatican's a snake and the largest altar in the world is a bunch of angels being eaten by a snake? Did Satan reveal that? Or did the Holy Spirit reveal that? Well, remember, Jesus is El, the Almighty God that came from heaven into the system we call the flesh. That's why he took on a host body. He died in the flesh to pay for your sins by proxy. Okay, so if someone's saying that I reveal stuff and I'm Satan, I'm a Satanist, well, then they're blaspheming the Spirit that's revealing it, which is called blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. It's the only unforgivable sin. It's the only one. I always tell people, call me a name. Say something like, oh, Jonathan, you're an evil piece of whatever. But don't say I'm a false prophet and don't say that the works I do are of Satan, because then you're done. Spiritually done. You're spiritually done. That's it. And then you don't have any chance to get converted after that. So then all you have to look forward to is eternal hell. Eternal torment. That's what hell is. Eternal torment. So, admonition, either listen or don't listen, but that's what the Bible says. So now tonight, I'm going to reveal to you things that the Lord God has revealed to me through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, again, I've laid hands on people that are blind. Lexi, she was in Grand Junction. A lot of people know about the Lexi thing because it was kind of a thing that happened, and people were trying to force me to go find this girl during the Grand Junction get together. You've got to go find this girl, Jonathan. You've got to go lay hands on her. I was like, stop. That's not how it works. I don't get to pick and choose who gets healed. I don't. That's not. Otherwise, I'd be out going to hospitals all day long, healing everyone I could of cancer, whatever was bugging. I mean, I would dedicate my life just to go lay hands on everybody if that's what the deal was. That's not how it works. The Lord sends me to someone or brings someone to me into my hemisphere, and then he tells me this one, and I do what he says. So I was in Grand Junction, and we had to get together at the corner of Rainbow and Casimir, which everybody that knows the testimony, that's a miracle. There's no way those shipping containers could have been at the corner of Rainbow and Casimir, as it was with Noah. As I made a covenant with Noah, the rainbow, so shall I make a covenant with you of everlasting peace. Covenant of peace, Casimir. That's what the word Casimir means, proclamation of peace. The Lord told me to look up Isaiah 54. I'll show you. It's right there in Isaiah 54. Miracle, miracle after miracle. So anyway, when I was there, there was people wandering around the property where the containers were. And several people had come up to me and said, Jonathan, you've got to go find this little girl. Her and her grandmother showed up. She's blind. You've got to go lay hands on her. And I was like, okay. We'll see where it goes. All right. I'd turn around, talk to some people, and some other people would say, Jonathan, you got to go find this little girl. She came with her grandmother, and I think it's her grandmother. And you got to go lay hands on her. I was like, okay, guys, just... You know, it's frustrating sometimes because I want to, but I don't get to pick and choose. And so someone had just told me that. They just said, Jonathan, you've got to find this. I was just like, okay. And I said, you know what? If God wants me to do it, he's going to set it up. That's what I said. I said, God, if God wants it to happen, it's going to happen. And right then I turned around to walk away from that person that was telling me what I had to do. And I was like, if God wants it to happen, he'll set it up for sure. Would you excuse me? And I turned around and I almost ran over Lexi. She was right behind me. She was standing right behind me. So when I turned around, I was like, oh, hey, how's it going? And she's like this, looking up through these really thick lenses. And I was looked down at her and she and her grandma, I believe it's her grandmother. She goes, hi, I'm so-and-so. This is Lexi. And we drove all this way, and man, my body just started buzzing so hard. I was like, whoa, this is, wow. And I looked at Lexi and I said, and she said, she's blind. She's like legally blind. She can't hardly see. And I looked at Lexi and I said, Lexi, you know what? The witness of the spirit that I'm getting right now is so strong that I'm going to lay hands on you for sure. Right now. And I said, I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but I guarantee you something's going to happen, because the Lord wouldn't have me doing this right now if something wasn't going to happen. I wouldn't be zinging like this, just buzzing. I know Mike MacGyver hates that. Ugh. Right, Mike? Anyway. So, yeah, anyway, so I was just buzzing, and I told Lexi, I said, so I'm going to lay hands on you. Don't put God in a box. Just give it some time. So let's do it. Okay. And I said, let's pray. So I held her grandmother's arm, and Lexi, I think I was touching everybody. I think we may have held hands and touched Lexi. I can't remember exactly. But anyway, I prayed over her and I prayed for her restoration. And her grandmother also had a really bad ankle, or something was wrong with her leg that had been persistent. Anyway, I laid hands on Lexi, and Lexi's eyesight's now 20/30. I started getting reports after the get-together that her eyesight had changed. I was like, praise God, man, your eyesight's gotten good. And her grandmother said, I think on the way back home, her ankle was healed. Just, she's like, oh my God, my ankle that's been a nightmare is good. So anyway, these are things you can find out. These are on, you can go on the Facebook channel and find out this stuff. It's easy to find out. Collectfiles.com. George Cortez in this driveway, it knocked the crap out of me when I laid hands on George. It's like a wall hit me in the chest, bam, against the car. I was like, oh, tears were coming out of my eyes as I looked over at George. I was like, oh. And George was looking at me like a raccoon. He was right here going, and I was like, I was like, are you okay? I didn't pass out. Oh my God, I didn't pass out. He was jumping around, jumping for joy, calling his wife. Okay, so when people say that I'm a Satanist, they don't know me. I'm a Satanist? No, no, no. My name is Jonathan Kleck, and I serve the living God, Jesus, Yahushua. Yeah, I'm a servant, an end-of-the-world harbinger, by the way. The world's coming to an end, and I think we're at the moment that it's about to happen, because all this weird stuff that's been going on in the peripheral with this Richard Montblanc stuff. See, what I've done is I've taken all these lies that people have said, and I've kind of put them in an order to give a more realistic picture of who a lot of other people were in the background that have been lying for years, and how they're still connected to this. How weird is all this? So anyway, I've organized things in a way to make a record for the world, and so the people that are involved know that when the Lord shows up, you got to give an answer to him, not to me. So, but the Lord did show me he's got things set up now, whatever that means. So I've also, like I said, there's other data points that have not been shared that will eventually come out, no matter what, period. Whether or not I'm alive or not alive, whether or not anything happens or doesn't happen, it will all come out. It's set that way. So anyway, so back to what I do. I am here as a harbinger. And when the Lord called me, the whole thing was this. You need to warn everybody, Jonathan, warn the world to turn back to me with your whole heart. Not just lip service, not just your mouth, not just saying it, but with your entire heart. Turn back to the Lord God with everything you have, like you mean it. Like, you want to get your sins wiped out before the end of the world comes. Because when it comes, nothing matters. The Bible says, what should it profit a man if he gains the whole world, but he loses his soul? That means the entire world, the entire world. And I know the flat earthers, it's a flat, like it's a globe. Go read your Bible. Now, there is a flat plane of existence, but it's a globe. Now, anyway, interesting thing. If you can gain the entire world, but you forfeit your soul, it means nothing. So what does that mean the most important thing is in your life? What do you think it is? To have a lot of money? To have the prettiest girl that is walking around on 2 feet? I used to think, you know, I mean, let's just be honest. I mean, beauty is attractive. It is. And I used to just, I was just like mesmerized by how beautiful women were. I was like, wow, she's beautiful. Wow, she's beautiful. But I never found who I thought it was that was right, except I married this girl, Dorothy Mays, and she was absolutely beautiful. And she had a modeling contract in New York. They were going to pay for everything. She was 6 feet tall. I was like, she's taller than me, which was weird. I was like, you can't wear heels, okay? I'm going to wear my boots. You can't wear heels. That's the deal. Anyway, she had a modeling contract in New York to go be a supermodel. And I was like, hey, that's all. Because that's, you know, that was one of the things she had worked on. Not really very hard even, but, you know, that's one of the things she did was modeling. And she got an offer to go live in New York, everything paid for, blah, blah. And she's like, well, this is what happened. And I'm like, good for you. I called her Dot. I was like, good for you, Dot. That's awesome. And she didn't seem very happy. She was like, oh. I was like, what's wrong? I thought this is what you wanted. And she's like, well, yeah, you know. And I'm like, well, don't you want to do it? And I knew that if Dorothy left, that our relationship would be over. I mean, come on. You go to New York, you're smoking hot. You're a model in New York. Do you really think that I believed that she was going to be like, oh, don't worry, I'll call you. It's like, whatever. I knew that our relationship would be over, but I loved her enough. I loved her. I truly loved her. And I wanted her life to be what she wanted instead of what I wanted. No, don't go. Don't go. What about me? I told her, I said, you know, that's so awesome. I'm so glad for you. And she was kind of not so happy. And I said, what's the matter, Dot? She goes, well, you know, I mean, there's only one reason I wouldn't want to go. And it's like, if you wanted to get married. And I was like, and I told her, I remember, I was like, Dot, I don't want to mess up your life. Because I had a past. And I was like, I don't want to mess up your life. I'll mess up your life. I don't want to do it. I love you too much. I don't want to be the guy that you could have gone to New York and been a supermodel and then you stayed with me and I screwed up your life. I don't want to be responsible for that. And she goes, well, I'd rather be with you than to be a supermodel in New York. That's what she said. And I was like, are you asking me to marry you? I was just like, are you asking me to marry you? Okay. I was like, if you're asking me to marry you, I accept. I was like, because I love you, but I love you enough to let you go. She died a year after we got married. She had 18 tumors in her liver. We had gone on our honeymoon, and then a year later, we went back to Cancun. She had a little swelling right under her right breast, just a little bit. It was a little puffy. And she showed it to me. She's like, look at this. And she's like, I was like, do you feel bad? Do you feel sick or anything? And she's like, no. And I was like, well, we need to get that checked out when we get back home. And we did. And guess what? She had 18 tumors in her liver. She had duodenal neuroendocrine cancer. And it was just horrible, 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 aggressive, just non-really survivable cancer. And I became just her 24/7 person with her 24/7. She died December 15th of 95. And at that point, I was like, you know what? Screw all this. Screw trying to do the right thing. I don't care anymore. I tried. I did my best. I tried to, you know, settle down. I tried to get married. It didn't work. It's not in the cards. And then I told you guys the story that I met this, my secretary wouldn't stop bugging me. She wanted to introduce me to somebody. I was like, leave me alone. Long story short, I met this girl. I had a really good time with her. I have to admit, we had fun. But I was like, look, I'm going to go be a pro sky surfer. So I'm training for the X Games. And, you know, it's a pretty deadly sport. I'm moving to California. So I'm just saying, don't get too attached because I'll be leaving in 3 months. And she orchestrated getting pregnant on purpose in order to stop me from moving to California because I was going out there to train for the X Games, sky surfing. And then next thing you know, I got kids, a child on the way. And without getting into all the details, I was like, yep, you know what? I'm going to embrace this situation. You know what? I'll still keep training for sky surfing. Just see where it goes. I'll just train here. And, you know, long story short. Anyway, she turned out to be just a total. I'd never met anyone like that in my life. I'd never been struck in the face in a relationship where someone was hostile, and I never experienced someone that was violent, and she was. And I used to tell her, she used to just whack, and I'd be like, whoa, for stupid stuff. I was like, what are you doing? I was like, you know what? I'm in martial arts. I go over and I train with these big guys that are, you know, on the east side. These are some bad, pretty tough guys. I don't mind when they kick me in the face. I don't mind if they punch me really hard in the face. Because, you know, we're in a ring, but you know what? When you do it, it really bothers me. I was just like, so would you quit doing it? Yeah. Yeah. She couldn't quit doing it. And so the whole thing was just a disaster. And I was like, this thing is awful. Anyway, long story short, I met Lou, and I was very much in love with Lou. And we got together, and then I got saved. And Lou was with me the night I got saved, and I was at the St. Anthony Hotel. And I'd been asking God, just, I wanted to know the truth. I was like, I just want to know the truth. The world doesn't make any sense to me. I don't get it. I've done all these things. I did Vlad Iwer. The trademarks made over $110 million in 1 year for Bausch & Lomb. I had to go sue Bausch & Lomb just to get them to pay me and to establish that I'm the owner of the trademarks. And I was like, are you kidding me? They could have just paid me the normal royalty fee and everything would have been fine. But it was just one fight after another. I was like, so sick of it. But I went and prevailed. And they said, if you tell anyone, well, you know, what rats we are, then we'll sue you back. And I'm like, okay, so you guys are dirt bags. You stole tens of millions of dollars from me. And I'm not supposed to tell anyone. That's part of the agreement. They redacted it. Anyway, I was like, whatever, you know, and then I was with Lou. I was like, okay, well, I own the trademarks. I'll just go do it all again because I knew how to do it at that point. I was like, I'll just go. I'll be able to pull in tens of millions easy. That's where I was at. I told the Lord, I didn't know God at all, but I knew God existed. I knew 100% that Jesus was real. I knew it. There's no doubt. I've known it my whole life. But my whole life, I saw different people saying, well, you know, a friend of mine, Gary, man, I love Gary, man. He's a friend of mine. And he went Mormonism. He's like, Clint, you got to be a Mormon. Oh my God, you got to be a Mormon. I'm like, oh, stop, stop, stop. We've got the only Jesus that you can get, that if you don't get this one, you got the wrong one. I'm like, okay. And I heard that same kind of dogma from all these other people. And I was like, just doesn't make any sense. You can't have all these different Jesuses. You can't. There's no way. By definition, you can't have all these different denominations. And then if you're not this one, Presbyterian, you're not going to heaven. If you're not Baptist, with all these rules, you're not going to heaven. If you're not Catholic and you don't worship the Virgin and Jesus, you're not going to heaven. If you're not Mormon, you're not going to heaven. I was like, it doesn't make any sense to me. I knew that Catholicism was pure hypocrisy because I was raised in it. You can go do all this bad stuff and just go do it. And then, oh, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. By the way, the Bible says, call no man Father but your Father in heaven. Isn't it weird? They get you in a little booth and they get you to say, okay, I did this, and you're talking through a wall, and I did this, and I did this, and I'm like, oh, okay, well, you know what? Say five Hail Marys and five Our Fathers, and you're good to go. I was like, what? I was like, that doesn't make any sense. I was like, okay, so I can go, like, Yeah, I've been arrested how many times, and I've done this and I've done that. All I got to do is say five Hail Marys and five Our Fathers, and that's it, and I'm good. That sounds like a get out of jail free card all the time, doesn't it? There's no change of heart. There's no repentance. There's nothing. It's just go sit in a pew sometimes on Sundays. Make sure you make the holy days of obligation. Do that every now and then, go in there and tell some guy you don't know through a screen, oh, I did all these naughty things. He's like, okay, well, do this, say five Hail Marys, five Our Fathers, and you're good to go. Have you ever prayed the rosary? Grab the rosary and start paying the beads. You'll be fine. No problem. Huh? It's just like, whatever. So anyway, I actually made an honest plea from my heart. I was at my house and I said, God, I know you exist. I know you exist. I know you're real. I don't know how to find you. Everybody has their own version of Jesus. I've heard it from too many people. If you don't have this one, you're wrong. If you don't have this one, you're wrong. And I very honestly said, I just want to know the truth. Nothing makes sense anymore. I don't get it. I have these little kids that need me really bad. I love my children. I have these other people now that hate my guts. I was like, all I was, someone set a trap for me to use children to make me marry them. That's just not right. That's whack. To try and change my entire course of my life by getting pregnant on purpose and lying to me that they were on birth control. She had told me, yo, I'm on birth control. Absolutely on birth control. Absolutely. And there's a couple stories that are not for public consumption about that, that I was made aware by a doctor that just admonished the shit out of her because of her lying about birth control. And when I found out, I was like, oh, you've been lying about that the whole, oh my God. It was like a moment where I was just like, wow. So anyway, yeah, I had some tough times. So anyway, I was just like, okay, I need to know. I know Jesus is real. I've always known it. I just don't know which one he is. I just want to know the truth. Now that I've set this whole thing up, would y'all like to know the truth of what the Lord God showed me, how he did it, the things he's allowed me to show the world, the absolute proof of understanding the world, life, death, who you are, where we come from, what's going to happen when you die, and what happens to all the people that set traps for others and the ditch that they will all fall into themselves? Would you like to know what happened to me? If you do, then stick around. We're not going to do any of the, drama from California crap. That's all going to work itself out now. Guaranteed. And while the people that hate me continue their hatred, by the way, the Bible says whoever hates their brother is a murderer at heart. I know that Jim Sullivan, even though I did a whole lot for Jim, hates me. I know that Karen hates me. I know that Kathy hates me. Chuck probably hates me. So if you hate people, you're a murderer at heart. That's what the Bible says. I don't hate any of them. I actually pray for them. I actually have cried for them, praying for them. I'm like, dude, just let it go, guys. Just. But they can't. All right. Now, I want to show you what the Lord showed me. I want to share with you supernatural. I want to play a video that was done by YouTube called The Heartbreak Hotel. Because you know what's interesting? The night I got saved, I was at the St. Anthony and I was trying to get Lou, my girlfriend that ended up becoming my wife. The night I got saved, I had to get her out of town because I had been in a second high-speed chase where people meant to do serious harm to me, and I didn't know who these people were. And because I had a past, I was like, I don't know who they are, though. I mean, if I knew who they were, at least I would have an idea of how to deal with the situation. But these people were so covert, and I didn't know who they were. And I was like, what is going on? And I was in this high-speed chase, and I was like, that's it. I got to get my girlfriend out of town. I'm a danger to her well-being. And I told her, you've got to go. I called her dad. I said, look, I got to send her. Where are you? They have different houses in different states. And I said, look, where are you guys at? I will send her to you. I told him, this is what's going on. I don't know who these people are. I need to get your daughter out of here. And he was like, thank you so much, please. And I did. I got her a ticket. I bought her a plane ticket. I said, you're going to go stay with your parents. I'm going to figure out who these people are. And I figure out where this is all going. And, you know, I'll call you. I love you. I'm so sorry. And so this is the setup for the night I got saved. I was at the St. Anthony Hotel. Yep. St. Anthony. So I was at the St. Anthony Hotel. I think we're on the 10th floor. And I was in a hotel room with Lou, and I was saying goodbye, letting her know, okay, look, when I figure out what's going on, I'll let you know. I had a handful of, couple shirts, pants maybe, several shirts. And as I was standing there saying goodbye to her, this blanket of energy just enveloped me. And I was like, whoa. It was a physical. It wasn't some mental thing. It was physical. Blanket of just, whoa. And I looked at my arms. I'm like, what's going on? All my hair on my body was sticking straight up. Like, whoa. I was buzzing really. And I was looking at my arms going like, what's going on, man? What is this? I said, what is this? What? I was like, what is this? And then I heard, Jonathan, read the tags and the clothes you're carrying. I've lost my mind. No, it's like, that's it. The pressure got to me. I cracked. It's like, Jonathan, read the tags and the clothes you're carrying. And I was just like, what? And I looked at Lou and I said, some source is communicating with me. He's telling me to read the tags and the clothes I'm carrying. Now, I can understand anyone that's standing there is like, oh, my boyfriend's lost his mind. I can understand that. I mean, if I was Lou, I'd probably be going like, yeah, okay, not good. Boyfriend's right up the cliff. And I said, yeah, he's telling me to read the tags and the clothes I'm carrying. The first thing I read, it said 100% nylon. I've lost my mind. No, I read 100% nylon, and I'm like, that doesn't make any sense, because I threw the clothes down on the bed in the hotel room, and I read 100% nylon, and he told me, read the tags in the clothes you're carrying. So I read the tag right here in the back, right there in the first shirt. The very first shirt. That means the Lord God had to know that I would have a nylon shirt with me. And I read 100% nylon. That didn't make any sense. Let me show you a picture so you understand what I'm saying here. So here's the word nylon right here. See, N-Y-L-O-N, nylon. It said 100% nylon. N-Y-L-O-N. And I thought, wow, maybe I've lost my mind. I went, oh my gosh, what? But then I started, but that electrical field, whatever it was me being anointed, getting ready for my anointing. That energy, that spirit was just buzzing all over my body. And I said, that doesn't make any sense. And then, as clear as a bell, the spirit said, turn it upside down, the word nylon. And I went, turn it upside down. And I looked at it and I said, 100% turn the word nylon upside down, Jonathan. And I did. And the word nylon, when you turn it upside down, when you rotate this like it's in the back of a shirt, was N-O-L-Y-N. And as I saw that, I looked at it and I had to sound it out. I looked at it and I was like, no lion, no lion, no lion. And then I heard the spirit say, 100% no lying. You may not lie at all. And I said, oh, 100% no line. Well, what was the thing I asked for in my very sincere prayer when I just wanted to find out who Jesus was? I said, I want to know the truth. Remember, there's all these different Jesuses, but everyone's got their own version. It doesn't make any sense. And I just said, the world does not make sense to me. Nothing makes any sense. You go work. I mean, I was in love with Dorothy. She's willing to give up her modeling career, and I marry her, and she's dead within a year. I mean, dude, whatever. And I get together with this other girl. She's got her target on me like I'm something to be hunted, because she sees that I have access to tens of millions of dollars, and she knows that this guy's going to be worth a crap load of money. So she decides to lie to me and get pregnant on purpose in order to lasso me. Oh, you belong to me now. Now I've got him tied to a kid. That's to tie someone to you on purpose by having a child, by lying to them and telling them that you're on birth control. And because I said, I can't be having sex if I just can't. No, I've got to go train sky surfing. And she lied and told me she was on birth control. And then I found out in front of the doctor what a horrible, heinous lie she had told me. It was horrible. I was like, good God, this is awful. Yep. You know what? I just very clearly heard the Lord say, tell him. I'm going to tell you what happened very quickly. So she told me she was on birth control. And then she said, one day she goes, she's acting all sound. I go, what's the matter? She goes, I'm pregnant. And I go, you're pregnant? How'd you get pregnant? You were on Depo-Provera. She told me she's on something called Depo-Provera. And I didn't know anything about what she said. It's just an injection, but it's like for a certain amount of months. And so she goes, yeah, I guess it didn't work. And I was like, oh, wow. Well, I went, looks like we're having a kid. Because I was like, okay, well, oh, wow. And then she wanted to have an abortion because she had been partying, using drugs that could affect the fetus. And she goes, I think I'm going to have to abort it. And I'm thinking, okay, because she had been partying and using drugs, so she didn't want to have the child. And I'm like, okay, that sucks. Now I'm going to go through an abortion with this girl. So I went with her to the abortion. I was standing in there with her, holding her hand as moral support with her. And the doctor was going to give her an injection in her, you know, into her uterus. And I was sitting there going like, oh, this is horrible. And she yelled at the doctor. She yelled at him. He said, I'm sorry, you need to hold very still because this needle could injure you. And she goes, well, God damn it, it hurts. And she yelled at the doctor. And I was like, wow, that was. And the doctor goes, well, if you would have come in 3 months ago for your Depo-Provera shot, you wouldn't even be here. And I looked over at her like, are you kidding me? Like, we're here because you lied about Depo-Provera. And I so at that moment, I was like, oh my God, this is horrible. My wife just died. This girl's having, now I'm having an abortion with this girl, and she lied about birth control. And what the, I was really just like, what in the world? So she has a procedure. We leave the doctor's office. We're driving. It's dead silent in the car. I'll never forget what I said to her. Even though I hadn't met the Lord, even though I hadn't asked for the Lord to show me who he was yet, we're driving and I didn't know what to say. And I felt so bad for her. I was just like, okay, you know what? I looked over and I said, look, and I'm not going to say her name. I just said, look, so-and-so. There's a story in the Bible. There was a woman that committed adultery and the crowd was going to stone her. And Jesus looked at, he stopped the crowd from stoning her. He said, whoever's without sin, cast the first stone. So I tell her, this is the story in the Bible that we're going to stone her. But Jesus said, whoever's without sin, cast the first stone. Go ahead, stone her. So one by one, the crowd had to leave because they all knew they were sinners. And I told her, I said, so I can't cast a stone at you. And I don't want to. I said, so why don't we put this behind us as quickly as we can and forget about it? But if you're truly sorry, don't ever do it again. That's what I told her. And so then at that point, I was like, okay, well, I'm supposed to be going to California, training skysurfing. And I was like, you know what? I was so concerned about her mental well-being and that she had been through that. And I was like, you know, I'm just going to stick around for a little while, make sure she's okay before I'm like, see ya, I got to go be a skysurfer. Bye. Thanks. Out of here. So because of my heart was wanting to take care of someone else's well-being, I let her stay in my house and I kept an eye on things and I stayed for a little while and she was fine. And after several months, you know, is back to a sexual relationship. And she's like, she was taking a pill at that time. And she had these pills that they opened, but there was a little ridge. There's all these ridges that went this way and it was designed to stay closed. You would have to force it open and, you know, bend the ridge and make it really, really pry it to make it sit open if you were to leave it on the counter. It was designed to want to be closed. That's the best way to put it. So anyway, so long story short, there I was living with her in the house, keeping an eye on things, you know, back to the relationship. I said, look, you know, she's taking birth control pills. Then, you know, here they are. I see them. Okay, so we start back to a sexual relationship again. And then I go in my bathroom to take a pee. She had the master bedroom. I had a different bedroom. And I had my bathroom down the hall. But she had a master bedroom with a master bath in her bedroom. It was all together. And so I would go in my bathroom to pee. And the pills would be laying open on my counter. And I'd be sitting there peeing. And I'd look over and I'd be like, why are those pills in my bathroom? And then I went and gave them to her and I said, hey, look, my parents are old school. If they come over, I just don't want them seeing birth control pills in my bathroom, please. And I give them to her. Well, guess what? They were there a couple days later, sitting in my bathroom, open. I'm peeing. I'm like, weird. Why is here? I go give them back. Hey, you need to put these up. I told you, please don't leave them in my bathroom. My mom and dad come over. They use that bathroom. And if they go in there, there's birth control pills. It's just awkward. I just, you know, these are yours. Put them in your bathroom. Happened again. And I was like, what's the deal? And then I went, oh, she wants me to see him. She's baiting me. So right then I was like, okay, you know what? Here, put these up. I just quit having sex with her. I was like, that's, you know, I don't feel comfortable right now. Sorry, no. I just totally backed off. Wouldn't have sex with her. Yep. And then one day I came home and she was all, I'm like, what's the, like, everything okay? She's like, I'm pregnant again. And I was like, really? You're pregnant again? I thought, did you take all your pills? And she goes, oh yeah, I took every one of them. Oh yeah, I swear. Oh yeah, I took every pill. I was like, okay, well, I guess, like, wow. I said, okay, well, it is what it is. And then I was just like grating in my brain. Well, she already did the Depo-Provera thing and I found out in a horrible way it wasn't true. And then I said, well, you know, if you're truly sorry, don't ever do it again. But here we are again. I was like, dude, what in the world? So I just said, you know what? I'm just going to put it on the shelf. Wait. So I was like, okay, I gotta know whether or not she took her pills or not. So I waited one day. I went and picked her up from school. She was in college at the time. I went and picked her up. She got in the car. She was in a great mood. I go, yeah, let's go grab some lunch. She's like, yeah, okay, great. You know, da da da. And I said, but you know what? Before we grab lunch, I need to run over to doctor. I'm not going to mention his name. Dr. So-and-so's office. He's a friend of mine. I said, he's going to do a blood draw on you, and he can tell me that your estrogen levels, what they are. And that way I know for sure that you took your birth control pills. Well, there's not such a thing. I was just like playing a game of poker with her. And as soon as I said that, she goes, I just wanted my other baby back. I'm sorry. I just don't know. So right then and there, she snapped and broke down and said, yep, I wasn't taking my pills. I was setting you up by letting you see them. And I'm pregnant again because I wanted my other baby back. And that's the relationship I was in. And I tried to make it work with her. I was like, my God, man, what are you doing, dude? I was like, why? I mean, I have a life too that I should be able to decide on, that you don't get to decide what everybody's going to do by lying, cheating, and being deceitful. That's crazy. That's crazy. I was like, now we have no trust in our relationship, nothing. And you're pregnant? Oh, my God. And I was like, you know what? Okay, Johnny again, Johnny's heart. Let's try and make this work. God works in mysterious ways. Next thing you know, I'm building the nest. I went and moved out to the drop zone. I was like, you know what? You can tap my house, just whatever. Actually, I didn't let her move in for quite a while. I just went to the drop zone and lived at the drop zone and just taught skydiving full time. I was just out there, skydive, 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 skydive. Maybe I'll die. Skydive, skydive. Yep, yep, yep. And then when it came time close to, you know, the baby coming, I built the nest, went back to my house. Okay, move into the house. Let's try and make this work. And then it was a nightmare from that point on. She was hostile. She was violent. Hit me in the face. Those kind of things. It was crazy. That's what was going on in my life. And that's when I was like, next thing you know, she's pregnant again. We're going to have another child. I was just like, okay, this is just, I'm in deep, 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 deep. That's where I was. She was using children as a way to, you're mine. You're mine, and whatever money you make is mine. And if you make the tens of millions, it's mine. It's like, okay. And so anyway, so yeah, long story short, now you know. And then when that, I finally said, that's it, I'm done. Because of a situation that had occurred that was too violent. I'm like, it can't happen anymore. You've got to go. I'll take the kids. Get out. And I was willing to raise the children myself. But she filed for a common law divorce, and I had to go fight her. And she came at me with the just hell hath no fury as a woman scorned, like she had been scorned instead of me being scorned. She said like she was done wrong. I was like, that's insane. So long story short, I had met Lou, and I was like, I should at least have a chance to have some kind of a life. You know, and now there's these little kids involved, and I want to take care of these little babies. I'll take care of all of them. I don't care. And I couldn't believe that I'd met someone as attractive and as beautiful as Lou, with so much going for her, that wanted to be with me, even though I had these three kids. And she's like, I look at it as a bonus. I didn't have to give birth to him, and I love all your kids. And I was like, wow, I can't believe it. That's awesome. And so, yeah. And Lou was with me the night I got saved. So after that, she and I got married and had a child. Now we're back to the hood. Let's go back now. Let's go back to the 100% nylon the night I got saved. So I've already told Marina, get away from me. Don't ever get out of my house. You're out. Well, I'm going to work, whatever. Well, I'll take the kids. Of course, she's like, no, you're going to be in court all these years fighting me, and I'm going to come at you with every lie I've got, which she did, but I still prevailed. So anyway, so I was with Lou. I'd met Lou. I had no intentions to get together with Lou. Just things happened the way they did. And I mean, I was like, I actually was like, no, I don't know. But things happened the way they did. And she was with me the night I got saved. And I said, you know what? I got to get this girl out of my life. I was willing to let go of Lou again because her safety was more important than me being with the girl I thought was going to be the person I was going to spend the rest of my life with, having gone through the girl that had set up this horrible, awful trap to try and destroy me. Anyway, so I was in the hotel room with her. Now, y'all ready? Read the tags in your clothes you're carrying. 100% nylon doesn't make any sense, does it? Nope. Lord said, turn it upside down. So I looked at 100%. I said, 100%. 100%. No lying. And then I heard 100% no lying, Jonathan. You must tell the truth. And my body had a reaction like nothing you can even imagine. Just was buzzing so hard. I was like, that's crazy. What the heck is going on? I knew a supernatural entity was there. And then look at the next one. I looked at the next one. There is a black pyramid with a line, an X through it. It was like some washing instruction. Just a black triangle with an X through it. And the Lord said, the pyramid is your enemy, Jonathan. I was like, what? The pyramid is my enemy. Now, without doing my entire testimony tonight on YouTube. It's in the Kleck Files twice. I've done this entire testimony on the radio. I've done it on YouTube. I was interviewed by Tribulation Now. I did the testimony. You can go look at it. It's got pictures from the hotel. I went back and I videotaped where I was, what was going on. I put the whole thing out there for the whole world to see. The Lord told me I had to. And I'm like, oh, man. Okay. So I put the whole thing on YouTube. I didn't want to. I did what the Lord told me to. And guess what? Inverting the whole world is the only way you know Jesus, by the way. The Jesus that showed me all the supernatural stuff, the supernatural spirit that's in me that heals the blind, cures the sick, reveals the Vatican's a snake, and that a serpent race is killing angels, that supernatural spirit is what lives in me. And that's what all these people like Donna and Jim and whoever else that want to call me a Satanist, that's who you're dealing with inside of me. So let that be known. He's the Lord God living inside of me as a temple. And I try to be as faithful as I can, unviolent, kind, give others what I have, do the best I can to help people, and put my life out there, even though I've been threatened so many times I can't count anymore. I had to take serious precautions at the house I live at just to make sure that if people were over visiting, there wouldn't be a massive drive-by and everybody that's standing in front of a window is dead. Okay, so now, while all the people like Donna, Montblue and company, and Jim Sullivan and his group of liars from his family go and slander me and are libelous, libel and slander, defamation, it's all sickening, but they're willing to go do all their channels of hate. Go look at all their channels compared to my channel. But I have to bring it up now because of the situation. Now, let's get back to the who is Jesus thing. Now y'all know my story, okay? As uncomfortable as it may have been, now you know. I was targeted by someone that said, you're mine, I'm going to tie you up with children, and I'm going to control you, and da-da-da-da-da, and I'm going to lie, and it's okay, too bad. All right, well, I won custody of all those kids because that very person went into a courtroom and said, Jonathan Kleck's crazy. He's on drugs. And I'm like, wait a minute. No, that's you. You're calling me what you are. Isn't that crazy? They call everybody else. They accuse everyone else of what they themselves are already guilty of. Does that look familiar? Do you see that in politics all the time now? I see it all the time. It's crazy. So anyway, I prevailed. I won custody of all my kids. And later down the road, Lou was with me the night I got saved. And because Lou never got converted, I ended up winning custody of my son from her as well. Now, someone that's a lunatic or a Satanist and all that good stuff doesn't win custody of three kids in San Antonio from an Hispanic female. They don't win another child custody in a state that I don't even live in where that child was. I won custody on both places because I told the truth. I was even my own lawyer in Minnesota. Had I not been my own lawyer, I wouldn't have won. Judge Tanike wrote me a very nice letter after I sent him my entire case of pleadings. Dear Mr. Kleck, I have read your voluminous document, and although you're not properly before the court, blah, 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 he outlined the case law and everything I needed to do to get custody of my child. And at that point, the opposing counsel knew that I'd caught his client committing what's called aggravated perjury, where there's you lie on purpose trying to change the outcome, and I was able to prove that. And so instead of filing any charges or any going any further, they were willing just to say, you know what, Jonathan, I love you. Let's not fight anymore. I'll give you our son. You just give me your word. You won't be hostile towards me. And I never have been. I've just been, okay, that's cool. Let's just be friends. That's who I am. That's what I did. That's what I've continued to do. And I've continued to try and maintain friendships with all parties involved. That's a fact. Okay. Now, and see, these people like the Gene Revel channel, all they do is spit out vitriol. Hey, JJ. Gene, you're a sick, twisted, evil man. That's all there is to it. I need to say it to you. You're a sick man. You're very sick. You're demonically sick. And that's a fact. And it's easy to see. Anyone can see it. I mean, when I say anyone, anyone that's not like you can see it. That's why everyone that's over at your channel, Gene, they're all like you. Isn't it funny I call you Gene, but you don't even want people to know what your real name is? Why not, Gene? JJ? Anyway, see my point? These are all the people I've been dealing with during this whole Richard Montblue thing. They're all aligned with the Gene Revel channel. Just go check it out. Sickness. Okay, now. So then, the Lord tells me, if you want to know the truth and you want to be my servant, 100% no lying. And I'm like, okay. And that night, he led me out the back of the St. Anthony Hotel. And when he did, and when I took the step, of faith to open the door to the back of that hotel, having already been shown that the people that were in that high-speed chase with me were waiting outside the hotel, I looked out the third-store stairwell window, and I saw the very people that I was in the chase with were sitting there waiting for me. And the Lord said, no, go out this door in the back of the hotel. It said, alarm will sound if door opens. I knew that if I opened that door and in the back of the St. Anthony Hotel and that door shut, that those guys could, they were obviously watching the hotel. So they knew if I came out the front door, they were going to tell me. If I went out the side door, there's probably people over there. But if I went out the alley and the alarm goes off to the whole hotel, you don't think the people that I'd been in the high speed chase with that day that were monitoring the hotel, you don't think they would have boxed me in the alley and killed me? Of course they would have. I mean, that's what I was looking at. Choice. Jonathan, open the door. Go out the door. Fire alarm will sound. If you open that door, the fire alarm will sound. It said, do not open door. Fire alarm will sound. And I was with Lou and I said, Lord, tell me what to do. Jonathan, open the door. Lou was going, don't open the door, grabbing my arm. And I was like, Lord, please, Jesus, tell me. Now all of a sudden I'm talking to Jesus. I never talked to Jesus before. I'm like, Jesus, tell me what to do. Jonathan, open the door. Lou, he's saying, open the door. Don't open the door, Jonathan. They'll kill us. I'm like, Lou, you don't have to go. I've got to go out this door. Don't open the door. They'll kill us. I said, you don't have to go. I've got to open this door. Even if I die, I've got to know the truth. 100% no lying is the truth. So he's telling me open the door, and I open the door. I push it open, and guess what? The fire alarm did not go off. There was no bells, no nothing. What's interesting is the whole hallway was under construction. So they may have turned that fire exit off. Anyway, how fascinating. Then I walk out the door. I walk down a little flight of steps, and then there's a ramp like this on the second story. And as I start walking, these are my feet. I'm walking. It goes like boom. And it sets down. It was counterbalance. It was a fire escape. But I went down the fire escape. I'm the guy that has the before the fire ministry. Warning the world like Noah told everybody. There's this flood, this rain that's coming. I'm building this ark. Everybody that wants to get in, nobody wanted in. Yep, you're crazy, because he wasn't one of them. I'm not one of them here anymore. I don't belong here. I'm in the world. I'm not of the world. So when I walked down that fire escape, boom, and it set down, standing right there, this person that looked like Alexander Siddig from the movie Kingdom of Heaven, he stepped up to me, and he had this aura, this glow, and he looked at me, and he goes, pray with me, my brother. Are you kidding? He's waiting there for my counterbalance steps to hit the ground. And I'm thinking, I'll probably get shot if I open this door. The second I open that door, knowing that I'd probably get shot in the alley, the second I opened the door, I didn't care anymore at all. The guys that were waiting at the end of the hotel, whatever, don't care. I walked down that, I walked, boom, sets down, pray with me, my brother. Guy steps right up to me. He looked like Alexander Siddig in the movie Kingdom of Heaven. And he came alongside of me, and we prayed to the sky, hands up. Water and light came down on me. I was filled, anointed with the Holy Ghost, beaming with light. What is going on? I was filled with life. I had never felt that ever. Wow. I was stupefied. After I said the Our Father, male energy, Our Father who art in heaven, El, the Almighty God, Jesus is Emmanuel in the system. And then after I finished the prayer and I was beaming with light, just, oh, which is, oh my God. I was alive. I'd never been alive like that. I never even knew what it was. I was just like, and I looked over at Michael and he says, now you say a Hail Mary. And I looked at him like, why? I looked at him. I was born and raised Catholic, guys. There's no reason I should ever question saying a Hail Mary. That's what I was taught to do my entire life as a little kid. Johnny, say a Hail Mary. Light the candle. Okay. And he looks at me and he goes, now you say a Hail Mary. And I looked at him like, no. Like, why? Because the spirit of truth had taken up residency inside of me. And I've had people out there on YouTube land malign, oh, you liar. It's like, whatever. Everybody gets the answer to the God I serve in the end. I'm trying to get you out of having to answer to the God I serve in the end. Like Noah, get on the boat now. Because if you don't, what's coming is going to destroy everybody. Believe me or don't believe me, but the evidence I have will prove it. The Vatican's a snake. You know, the Hail Mary thing. So when he told me, now you say Hail Mary, I was like, whoa. And he just nodded like, do it. And then I started saying the words. And then I felt that life and that light and that energy leaving my body. I was like, no, 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 no. Because I didn't want what had just taken up residency in me to go away. I was like, no. But I felt it going out a little bit, but then it stopped. And I was like, oh, and I felt death when I said the words to the prayer, the Hail Mary. I was like, I feel death. What happens when you turn the virgin upside down? You know, like nylon, no line. Well, the virgin becomes a dead sheep. I wonder what the odds are on that. So the virgin, when you turn the virgin upside down, like Jonathan, read the tags and the clothes you're carrying, 100% nylon. What's the word nylon become upside down? No lion. So if I turn the virgin upside down, it's a dead sheep. Oh, the virgin, you know, like when you say a Hail Mary to the virgin. So when I said those words, I felt death. This is a martyr of my testimony. It's been out there for 20 years almost. Maybe not 20 years, but it's been out there a long time. I got saved in 2002. So anyway, then I became a harbinger right then and there. Now, without going through the whole wild set of events that happened after that and just led up to where I'm at today. Let's go to the evidence now. Let's go to the evidence. So, see, the word N-O-L-Y-N is the word nylon upside down. So 100% nylon, if you say 100% and then you say no line, isn't that the absolute truth? There's the absolute truth. I just showed you how to get converted. You turn the world upside down, your eyes become single, and your whole body's full of light. Otherwise, you have one eye that's light, one eye that's dark. Light and dark. 100% no line. Truth and lies. 100% no line. Your eyes become single, and your whole body's full of light. Are you willing to tell the truth, even if it means your ass, yes or no? Even if it means you're in huge trouble. Do you know the Lord put me through a test that very night? He did. I had to go through a test right after I got saved that I would tell 100% truth, and it was awkward and uncomfortable. But I told the truth. It's all in my testimony. I'm not going to go over it all again. Y'all can go find that on the Kleck Files. But now, here I am, and all this crazy stuff's happening. It's kind of interesting, this whole wild thing that happened in California. So many people are ready to condemn me. Why? All I did was help them. Psalm 37, they repaid me evil for good. That's what I got repaid for, what I did for these people out in Houston. I got repaid evil for good. And so everyone that aligns himself with them and says the same things like Donna's saying, that's okay. Because there's a right side up, upside down paradigm. It's interesting. Someone left a comment on the last video I did and said, well, you've got, guess how many times Donna's been arrested? Zero. And how many times have you been arrested? 21. 21 times before I got saved. Ask me how many times I've been arrested since I got saved. Okay. But it's interesting because the person that wrote that comment on YouTube, Let me see if I can pull it up and show you her. Show you her Spyglass Realty moniker. So the person that wrote the comment, I like to go look at the channel of whoever's leaving the comment. Her name's Karen Banks. She's a realtor. She said, Karen, or I'm sorry. The girl is named Karen Banks. She's a realtor. She said, how many times have you been arrested? 21. How many times has Donna been arrested? She said, zero. Like, inferring that I'm the one that's guilty. I'm like, well, okay. So let me show you her channel real quick, just so you can see it. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me enlarge this. So you can just see it real quick. I want to make sure it comes through. Let's see. Karen Banks Realtor. But now let me show you what's at the top of her realtor thing. Let's see if we can zero in. You see the word Spyglass? There you go. Spyglass Realty. You see that circle that's around the spy? That's the same as the right side up, upside down paradigm. That same as the virgin. Sheep one way, virgin the other way. It's the system. That's the system. Spyglass. Right side up, upside down. That is the system that we're trapped in. So, Karen, just for your information, just so you know, yeah, I don't care if people know I was arrested 21 times. That's what Christ did for me. I'm a new creation. So, anyway. All right, now, let me show you what's going on. Let me show you what is happening in the world. Let me show you what is happening to the world. Okay, so, here we go. Looks like we had a, hopefully we didn't have, I didn't have a major catastrophe, or we'll see what happens. Okay, it looks like it were, it, I would say, let me show you what's happening in the world. Okay, so anyway, so see, there's a right side up, upside down paradigm, good and evil, light and dark, Cain and Abel. Cain is down, Abel's up. See, good is up, evil is down. See, heaven is up, hell is down. Life is up, death is down. So let me just show you that again, very quickly in some imagery. So the word nylon, when you turn it upside down, is no line. Jesus was crucified right side up. Peter was crucified upside down. Jesus was on the cross, it says, from the sixth hour to the ninth hour. From the sixth hour, there is darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. Six and nine, they're reversals. See, in the Bible, it's all woven into it. All the truth of this is woven in. Look at the gift of God is eternal life. See the word life? Just turn this upside down and it spells death. The wages of sin is death. Life is right side up. Death is upside down. The movie, The Princess Bride. See it? Princess Bride. Just turn it upside down. It still says Princess Bride exactly the same. See it? What about Alicia Keys? The girl that sang Obama's on fire. Remember that him and Michelle rule the world. Obama's going to set the world on fire. You better believe it. Here you go. You see the A and the K? You see how this letter A, all you got to do is turn it upside down. And that's what makes the K. They just put the little line there. So Alicia Keys, no different than Spyglass, Boys and Girls Club. See it? Upside down, a movie, whatever. Bono knows. He's holding the BMW. You just flip, you invert it. Same thing. Porsche, no different. Vampire Academy, the V and that. Why didn't they simply cross the A? Why not? Why wouldn't you cross the A? Well, because it's an inversion. It's identical. You know, like Spyglass Realty. What's the difference? Okay, so right here, the Bible says, now from the sixth hour, see the number six, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. Because when you turn it, there's darkness, you turn it upside down, the ninth, six and nine. Six and nine again. Go listen to Woman with the Spinning Head by U2. I mean, it's woven into the fabric of so much stuff that you see, but you just don't notice it. Under Armour, see? Under Armour. That's the U and the A intersecting, making their little I right there. I mean, look at this. New man. They wrote it. Look how they wrote this. N-E-W. Just turn this upside down. It's exactly the same. It's no different than 100% no lying. You know, so it's the same thing ad infinitum. And I've shown it to people. And it's oddly enough, that's what's on my parachute. This is the parachute the Lord God had me made. V for vengeance. V for vengeance. And it just happens to make a big red X. That's the Lord designed that parachute through me. Okay. Now, I want to play a video by U2 called A Room at the Heartbreak Hotel because it reminds me of me and Lou. I was like, I was very much in love with Lou. We were very much in love. But Lou never got converted. And after I got converted, even though we'd been together, I don't know exactly how long we were together before we got married, but after I got converted to St. Anthony, we got married after that. As soon as I got this common law divorce finalized with the other person, I married Lou immediately because the Lord told me I had to either quit living in sin or marry her. And I asked her, well, if you want to get married, great. If not, that's okay. I totally understand. And she said, oh, I want to marry you. I want to have a child with you. And so we did. We had a child. But she wanted me to be the Johnny that did Vlad Eyewear and made shitloads of money. That's the Johnny she wanted. She didn't want the Johnny that was willing to work in construction, be content that we had everything we needed. Instead, she wanted the other Johnny that had all the money and could go anywhere and do anything he wanted whenever he wanted. And that Johnny was gone. I didn't care about the money anymore. I was like, yeah, but if I go fight tooth and nail to make the tens of millions again, then it's like I've got my soul back and I can show people what the Lord's shown me. That wasn't going to work. You two, A Room at the Heartbreak Hotel. I want you to look at the moniker. What do you see? Right side up, male and female upside down. You see that? Let's look right here. Here's a cover of an album called War. There's one called War that's got the boy in the helmet. Why would you have a little boy wearing a helmet called War? Because male and female energy are at war within the host body system. Not boy against girl, but energy. Twin female energy, 2x energy from the pit, is the most evil thing there is. And that's what's taking over the world right now. Energy. That's what's happening right now. And that's what's taking over the hearts and the minds of men and women. Doesn't matter. That's why there's all this gender confusion going on in the world. That's why. Now, remember, the standing up, the resurrection means the standing up again. In Ezekiel, it says, and Lucifer sits in the seat of Elohim. It means to sit, to be in the center of, to sit in the midst of the population. I've done videos on it. I've done a lot of scripture. But again, all this nonsense out in California with all these people making all these crazy claims, even though they're involved, is really eating up the clock for me trying to help people, showing you the way to get out of the trap that you're in. There's the trap. This is the trap. You want to see how to get out of the trap? That's how you get out of the trap. Your eyes become single. Your whole body's full of light once you get out of the trap. Because, see, light is up, dark is down. So if your eye gets inverted and your eyes become single, then you're out of the trap. But there are those that work for the enemy that know it's like that, but they're demonically infused. Gene Rebel, that's just the Gene Rebel channel. Just be honest. Their channel is nothing but hate, lies, and accusations. That's all they do. That's satanic by definition. Hate, if you hate your brother, you're a murderer at heart. Satan was a murderer from the beginning. Lies, lots of lies going on over there. Anyone that lies is a child of Satan. So child of Satan by definition. Whoever hates his brother, whoever lies. So the channel is hate and lies. Satan is called the accuser of the brethren. Hey, JJ, yeah, did you do this? You're just a little satanic imp. That's all. And then they want to get to me so bad because what am I doing? I'm ratting out Satan. I'm showing you where Satan lives inside of you. He's the darkness in you. He's the hate in you. He's evil. He's the lies in you. If you don't repent 100% from lying, you're satanic. If you lie 1%, you're satanic. You got to give it up. You got to be willing to tell the truth no matter what. I've caught so many people lying in the whole Richard thing. It's ridiculous. That's how you know. Ready? A room at the Heartbreak Hotel. You see the guys up right side up and the girls upside down? Now, I'm going to do this. Here's what I want to do. I'm going to play this video, and then I'm going to wrap it up so you don't guys don't have to sit here for 5 hours. Then the next video I'm doing is this folder right here. I'm going to do this folder right here. You know what? Let me just show you something really fascinating that's in this folder. This is all these dead sheep. You know what? I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to put this video on YouTube right now. I'm going to stay up late. I'm going to do this whole folder right now. I'm just going to go through the pictures in that folder. Because when you see the pictures in that folder and you see how it fits the paradigm of the world, and that's the whole thing's about serpents destroying sheep. What's that all? Well, the serpent race is down inside of you. The sheep race is up inside of you, down and up at war within you. Good and evil. Evil is down, good is up. Light is up, dark is down. And it's in you. Cain and Abel, cannibal. So now you're your own cannibal. And the way that happened is because you were willing to take the forbidden fruit and be part of a cannibalistic system. That's why the first two kids are named Cain and Abel, cannibal. It's a no-brainer. And then when I show you this folder, I mean, the whole thing bears witness to it. I mean, here I am hugging Lou before I got converted at my art gallery. And she gave me a greeting card that's a serpent eating a sheep. There's the serpent with its mouth open, and there's the sheep with the teardrop coming out of its eye. But I couldn't see it. I wasn't able to see it until after I got saved. Why would she give me a card with a serpent eating a sheep? There's the serpent right there. There's the eye of the serpent. There's the mouth of the serpent right there. Why is there a dead sheep here? Why is there a serpent eating a sheep? You know what I noticed? When she gave me the card, I was like, why would she give me a card with two girls sitting in a tree? It seemed kind of weird. I was like, And then I was like, no. Did you know that the Vatican is a snake? It's a serpent. You know what it's doing? Eating a sheep. So the whole Vatican, the building itself, is a serpent eating the sheep. And here my wife is giving me a card with a serpent eating a sheep. Do y'all think that's kind of weird or what? Do you think it's kind of weird that the hieroglyph of Akhenaten and Nefertiti, I can see the serpent being right inside Akhenaten. There he is. There's his eye, nose. Frowny mouth, top of his head right here, his neck. But his head and his neck turn into a penis and a scrotum. Wonder why. Well, because we bred with that race. The serpent and the sheep race are bred together. Here's Nefertiti. There she is. I just colored her in yellow a little bit, showed you what's what. Why is that a dead sheep? Why has Nefertiti become a dead sheep? Let me just invert it for you. See the dead sheep? There's the sheep's eye, there's the tongue, there's the nose, there's the teardrop. So why is a Nefertiti a dead sheep? Why is there a serpent being eating a sheep? I mean, does anyone know? I do, because I'm a harbinger. I'm here to show all this to you guys so you guys can get out of the trap that you're in, which is the right side up, upside down trap that you're all caught in. So let me give you a yes or no answer. It's a yes or no. Is that a sheep with its tongue sticking out? It's a yes or no answer. I told you when I prayed Hail Mary, I felt death. I'm a sheep. I'm one of God's angels. And when I prayed Our Father, I was filled with life. But when I said the words to the virgin prayer, I felt death. Isn't it wild when you turn the virgin over? It's death of a sheep, of an angel. Because the female energy in the system is destroying the male energy in the system. And it's cannibalizing it. It's perfect. This is perfect understanding of everything. Female energy within the system, the down, is destroying the up. It's cannibalizing it and taking it to the pit and producing locusts from the pit. That's where the locusts come from. That's why Satan is the king of the locusts. 9:11, Revelation 9, verse 11. They had a king over them, the angel of the bottomless pit. It's kind of interesting that, you know, I mean, with everything that's going on, it's, you know, a little awkward to talk about it. But, I mean, let's just be honest. If I can see this well, and I can show you things that are this supernatural, why is it that a cop car from Austin has a serpent being on the door? See that? There's the eye. There's the eye. There's the mouth. There's the star in the middle of the head. See it? That's like the central processing unit. You know, like the receiver. Beep, beep, beep. Eye, mouth. Why does a police car have a serpent being on the door in the form of a shield? Let me ask you a question. Is that a serpent being? Yes or no? Or am I crazy? Or how about I can see, but you can't? That's why the Bible says they'll see, but they won't see. They'll hear, but they won't hear. And they will not understand. And they will not turn to me and let me heal them. So I'll ask you this. Is the Vatican a snake? It's a yes or no answer. Well, let me pull it up and see if it is. So if the Vatican is a snake, the whole building's a snake. Let's just do this. So this is either a yes or no for the Gene Revel channel, for Karen and Jim, for everybody in the world. So if I'm wrong on this, then you guys may have a chance of being against the God that I serve. I serve the God of light, the God of life, not the God of death that they do, but I serve the God of light, life. I serve Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, El, the Almighty God in the flesh. So let me ask you a question. It's a yes or no answer. Is this the head of a serpent with a split tongue coming right out of the mouth? Right here. Is that the head of a serpent? Here's the whole building facing the other side direction. Is that an upside down cross? It's a yes or no. Is that a big black keyhole with an upside down cross at the bottom of a black keyhole? Is this the head of a serpent right here? It's a yes or no. Is that a head of a serpent wearing a crown? It's a yes or no. If the answer is yes, and everyone that doesn't see or believe or understand it is in trouble with the God that I serve. You're in trouble because that means you haven't made your conversion. Because if you see but you don't understand what's going on here, that means you're delusional. Here is the serpent wearing the crown. There is his split tongue. And that building right there is a serpent as well. Audience Hall. Anyone has to just go into Audience Hall and you can see that the thing's a serpent. It's a no-brainer. Here's the head of a serpent. Here's the head of a serpent. Here's the Vatican. Here, the whole thing's a snake. So yes or no, is it a snake? Gene, Kathy, Karen, Chuck, Jim, yes or no? So if it is, everybody's got to answer to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. They don't have to answer to me, but I'm tired of being maligned. I'm tired of being lied about. But isn't that what Satan does? Satan's a liar. Satan's a false accuser. Satan does stuff that's evil behind people's back and sets things up and tries to create false narratives. That's what Satan does. I don't do that. See that? See this? The truth is what judges everybody. Okay? Let me ask you a question, yes or no. Is that a tidal wave coming over a seven-story building right there? Yes or no. That's your new $10 bill. Did you know I prophesied out of the sea shall come fire and smoke and a devouring wind? Water as high as the walls of Jerusalem will cover the city by the sea. And did you know those very words are on your money? Water as high as the walls of Jerusalem. There's your $10 bill. Oh my God, there's water as high as the walls of Jerusalem. It's a seven-story building. There's one place where the walls are 72 feet. Look at that. Wow, it's a nuke going off in the background and a tidal wave covering a seven-story building on your $10 bill. What, isn't that crazy? Because the Twin Towers is printed on your other $20 bill and the Pentagon being bombed. Wow, that's just probably a coincidence, right? What about the federal building bombing being on your old 20 that I showed the world? Oh, you're a false prophet. No, I'm a prophet of the Most High. End of story. Huh. What about this? There's the $100 bill. Is that, look, out of the sea shall come fire and smoke and a devouring wind. You want to see it? Look, it's on the $100 bill. Look, there's the buildings being destroyed by a devouring wind. Oh, wow. Totally clicks a false prophet. No, he's a prophet, and y'all are in deep trouble. But see, all through history, what they've done is they've killed the prophets and they've maligned them and done horrible things. That's because prophets know the truth. They speak the oracles of God, which is what I do, and that's why so many people hate me. Jesus said, if they hated me, they'll hate you. The servant is not greater than the master. If they hated me, they'll hate you. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you. If they called me the prince of demons, how much more will they, my followers? Gene? See, there's the devouring wind. Fire and smoke and the devouring wind. Wow, it's on your $100 bill. $10 bill shows the tidal wave. Huh. So is the Vatican a snake? Yes or no? There's the Vatican. Does that... someone who had a pretty good job doing gifts. Look at that. It's a snake. That thing's a snake wearing a crown. What's in the mouth of the snake? A bunch of angels. So the snake is eating angels. Okay, end of story. The serpent race is eating. So the serpent race, which is inside of us, is eating the angelic race, the sheep race, inside of you. And the only way to stop the process is to turn back to the Lord God. 100% nylon doesn't make any sense. 100% no line. Jonathan's converted. I went through my test the night I got saved. Yeah. Okay. Now we're back to what I do. Woo! And like I said, we have a lot more information, but it's, you don't put everything out there so the opponents have everything. That would be foolish. So we have other stuff that, in the event, stuff that shouldn't happen happens. All that stuff goes right where it's supposed to go. So those that are responsible, there's no way out of the trap that they set. But again, I'm content to leave everybody alone. But everyone has to be nice. Everybody just be nice. I don't think they can do it. See, serpent's a snake. Snake, he's not a very nice guy. Do you ever wonder why the Egyptians... You ever wonder why the Egyptians wore... Why did the Egyptians wear those headdresses? Well, the Egyptians were the serpent race that enslaved God's children. That's why. There you go. That's a pretty good gif, right? There you go. Oh, you're manipulating the picture. Oh, really? Am I manipulating that picture? No. So, see, when I tell you guys, when I prayed to the Virgin after I got saved, I felt death. Why does the Virgin turn into death? Because it is death. Neither shall you touch it, lest you die. The Bible says in Genesis 3, and the serpent said to the woman, has God told you, shall not eat from any of the trees of the garden? We may eat from every tree of the garden except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Neither shall you touch it, lest you die. You know what the word touch means? To lie with a woman. So how do the angels from heaven get to lie with a woman? Well, because the twin female parthenogenic system starts a host body system. They go forth and they multiply and they make a whole bunch of them. And then the angels that want to come in and have sex with human women, they are allowed to because they have free will. This is what the whole mystery of the whole universe is about. You have free will. And if you want a host body, you can have one. But you're subject to death because the host body is attached to the pit. Let me show you that in this crazy tattoo this guy's got. You see the Virgin's a dead sheep? It's always dead sheep. What's with the dead sheep? Always the dead sheep. Let me show you this tattoo. You see this tattoo? It's a sheep. There's a sheep's eye right there. There's a sheep's ear right there. There's a nostril. There's a line in the lip. There's a bottom of the lip. Okay, but it's also a demon yoked to an angel. Let me show you that. So the whole thing's a dead sheep, but the whole thing is also a demon. You only see half of his face. See it? And then you have the angel, and the angel's like, no, he's trapped to the demon. The demon also has a penis and a scrotum made out of his image. And then there's the devil looking up from the pit because that's his system. So the whole thing's a sheep. The whole thing is a demon attached to an angel, and the devil from the pit is just waiting for his food, which is us, angels. We're the food for the pit. That's what the pit does. Now, here it is with no drawing on it. Ready? There it is. I can see right what it is. Oh, wow, look. Look at it all get filled in. Oh, what a great gift this guy did. Wow, look at that. And look at the isotoxal star coming right out of the tip of the penis. Isotoxal, go look up the definition of isotoxal. There's the devil in the pit. There's a system, an angel and a demon in the same body. By the way, this is a human heart, by the way, as well. This is a human heart. And then when you turn it upside down, it's this worm from the pit just consuming all the energy. You know, the Bible says it's better to enter heaven with one arm than to be cast into hell where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. Is that a sheep right here? Is that the eye of a sheep, ear of the sheep, the nose of the sheep, neck of the sheep, the front leg of the sheep? Yep. Is that a raptor eating the sheep? It is. I put Cain and Abel because that's the system. Cain and Abel, cannibal. Get it? Okay, how many times do you want me to do this? Here's the altar in the Vatican. So it turns into a male penis and the female reproductive system as well. So let's look at that big dead sheep. You see the dead sheep? Is that a dead sheep? It's a yes or no. Yes, it is. It's in the mouth of a serpent. It's the male and female reproductive system. So now, wait a minute. But Jonathan Cleck's a false prophet, remember? Everybody. Let's look at this big thing I did on the papal regalia. Now, that's on the corner post of the entire canopy inside the Vatican. Well, let me just show you how to perceive it. I made the dragon's eyes kind of orange and yellow. There's an eye. There's an eye. You see the cross right there and the cross right there? That's two keys making an X. You see the guy right there in the slave collar? There's a guy right there. He's in a slave collar. But the whole thing is a dragon with his mouth. This is the mouth wide open. So let me shrink it down. There's a dragon. Eye, nose, mouth wide open. Why is there a dragon with his mouth wide open on the corner post of the Vatican? Why does it turn into a bird of prey, an owl? Why are there two X's right where the eyes of the dragon are? So there's an X. There's two X's. There's two X's. See, why are those things there on the corner post of the canopy inside the Vatican? Why are they there? Why does it turn into a locust? Because locusts come out of the pit. That's what the angels are being transmuted into. You know there's a band called Aerosmith, right? Arrow means of the sky, arrow. You know what a smith is? Something that smiths and changes it. Aerosmith, change the angels, smith the angels. What about a band called... What about a band called... Alice in Chains. You know what Alice means? Of nobility. Alice in Chains. Angels in Chains. Alice in Chains. Of nobility in chains. Yeah. Once you know the truth, it's easy to figure a lot of stuff out. There's a lot of band names that you'd be really surprised if you knew them. I mean, if you knew the truth, I'm sorry. If you knew the truth and you just paid attention. Do you know why the band U2 is called U2? I do. Because a U2 is a spy plane that flies at the atmosphere. And he knows that the system is one up, one down. U2. See, you're two. U2. But those guys are covertly in the system, kind of like I am. I'm kind of like... I don't care if people know that I know the truth, but obviously Satan and his minions, as someone always calls the people that follow my ministry. There's this person that always calls the people that follow my ministry minions, and he's kind of hostile too. But yeah, let's see. Is that the female reproductive system right there? It's a yes or no. So, well, there's the actual female reproductive system. And there's the Vatican sheep turned upside down. Wow, look, it's the female reproductive system. Wonder what the odds are. So all I had to do to show y'all the truth was to turn everything upside down. Does the Bible say these that have turned the world upside down have come hither also? It sure does. So here's Cain upside down. Here's Abel right side up. Because, and Cain and Abel, say it together, Cainable. Let me ask you a question, yes or no. Is that a bug? Is that an insect? Is that the eye of an insect, eye of the insect? And is this the mandibles of an insect? It sure is. Why would a girl's dress be a big bug? Huh. You know, it's common. I can show it to you over and over and over and over and over again. And so it's not really something that's up for debate. It just means the people that are spiritually blind can't see. Is this called the Twin Towers? Were they bombed? They were. Did you know they're printed on U.S. currency notes? The bombing of the Twin Towers are printed on your $20 bill. So's the Pentagon. I showed it to the FBI. I went in and gave them a presentation. Said the bombings are printed on our money. The Twin Towers, the Pentagon, printed on this $20 bill. Let me show you the old $20 bill. It's got the federal building bombing in Oklahoma City. Scratch my ingrown hair. Sorry, guys. I got to grab that. All right. So let's watch a real quick little shorty about the U.S. currency. And then I want you to watch A Night, A Room at the Heartbreak Hotel and see if you guys can just figure out the simplicity of the video to show you the entire system. Because it's a perfect representation of the night I got saved, even. And I'm like, how in the world did he possibly do that? Here we go. Let's do the U.S. currency right now. So let's go to let's go to Jim Sullivan, new Jeff Pesca. Before he did his ridiculous video, Jonathan Kleck followers, a high profile follower of Jonathan Kleck, has a handler. You know what? I've never heard the terms handler being used except from Donna and Jim. Jeff Pesca. He never said Jeff's name, Jonathan Kleck's handler. Talking about Jeff Pesca dealing with Richard. I mean, that's so stupid, Jim. It's like, dude, really? It's like, you're a joke. Okay, here we go. Ready? Ready? U.S. currency. Yes or no?
Reports have shown, hidden in the United States currency notes reveals something very insidious. These images are disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised. Reports show the bills produced and distributed for the United States have printed on them bombings that have happened in the past, and bombings that will happen in the future. The immediate threat coming is a nuclear attack on New York City. It has all been planned from the beginning, and there is no stopping what is to come. These are clips taken from a video called Destruction of America, produced by Jonathan Kleck, and have been deleted by YouTube to continue to consume.
I'm
going to
pause it. Yes or no, is that the Twin Towers printed on the U.S. currency? Yes or no, right there. So either that is the Twin Towers or it's not. If it's not the Twin Towers, then okay, then I've been wrong about all of it. But I guarantee you, that's the Twin Towers printed on your U.S. currency right there. There it is.
We are now looking at the 1998 U.S. $20 bill. Alongside the Twin Towers moments after the attack that took place in 2001. As you can see, the money printed years prior to the attack is identical to the attack on the Twin Towers. Now we will turn the bill over to see the Pentagon bombing on the same bill.
Okay, so now just take a moment and try and wrap your brain around what you're looking at. Do you understand? You're looking at the Pentagon bombing printed on your $20 bill. So on one side is the Twin Towers blowing up. And on the other side is the Pentagon blowing up. If y'all don't know that that's the most stupid, obvious thing in the world, and you're like, oh, no, it's not. Okay, well, then you're still in your delusion. And the Bible says, because they had pleasure in unrighteousness, God will send them strong delusion, so they believe the lie. You see that? That's the Pentagon. There's the building right there. There's the windows. There's the explosion. There's the other part of the building. And I've matched it on computer. I showed it to the FBI.
Pattern. This is now two
There it
attacks
is.
that
You see
happened
it?
on the same.
There's the Pentagon bombing printed on your money.
Day identically printed on the same United States $20 bill. If you are skeptical that this is real or think it might be a coincidence, this is not the first time they printed an attack on your money. Let's quickly review the older $20 bill. This is the
Okay,
alphanumeric
so
printing.
now check it out. There's three layers of ink on all the bills. All you got to do is scroll the mouse and it shows you each layer. That technology is no longer available. They took it off the market, so you can't do it. What's fascinating is the edges of the building are rounded. I'm going to go back.
Building
Watch
bombing.
this. Look at this. I mean, come on. You see these? Look right here. See the corners of the building going up? They're like rounded. You see the long rectangular windows right here? Okay, take a look at the bill.
Let's quickly review the older $20 bill. This is the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building bombing that took place in Oklahoma City in 1995. Some key characteristics worth pointing out is the rounded corners on the ends of the building, the face blown off, and the floors of the building jutting out. I will now take an image from the Oklahoma bombing and lay the $20 bill on top of it. As you can see, we have another perfect match. Now we will go
Now
over the
there's
bombing.
the new $100 bill. Isn't that's when I had to go to the FBI and let them know. I'm like, guys, I had to. The Lord told me to come over here and show you the older bombings are printed on the money, the Twin Tower, the Federal Building bombing, the Pentagon bombing. They're all printed on your money in your wallet. And now I prophesied, out of the sea shall come fire and smoke and a devouring wind. That's a nuke. Well, guess what? You got a new $100 bill, and it just happens to be printed on the money, the words that came out of my mouth. Jonathan collects a false prophet. He's a Satanist. No, you guys are delusional. And y'all are about to see the end of the world, and you're not going to be ready, and you're going to go into the greatest horror the world's ever seen. That's what's going to happen.
That is to come. This is the United States $100 bill. Folded into the same upside down pentagram, you can see New York City being consumed by an explosion. There is hidden watermark ink
I
on the
want to
bill that
explain
cannot be
something.
seen.
See, you have to make every bill into a pentagram. Well, a right side up pentagram makes a five-pointed star on the inside when you connect the vertices. We're the stars from heaven. We're the angels. We're represented by a five-pointed star. What happens when you invert a five-pointed star? It becomes what's called the sigil of Baphomet, which is the church of Satan, because your body is the church of Satan. Where Satan lives is in your body. You're the house of Satan.
seen with the naked eye. Putting the image into computer software, I will show you each layer of ink that shows you
Out
the
of the
full
sea shall come
destruction
fire and smoke and a devouring wind. You want to see it? Ready? There it
of
is.
New York City.
So
With
if
each
I
layer of ink.
prophesied that and then the US currency came out and it's got a devouring wind knocking out all these buildings, and I'm the one that showed everybody the other bombings on the other currency notes, and then I said words that equal those bombings. What are you, crazy? I mean, it's a no-brainer. So stupid. Oh, it collects the balls from it. No, you're a demon inside of a body, and you're terrified because you know the Lord's coming, and you're trying to get rid of the prophet, which is what they always do.
Added, you can see the movement of the explosion coming towards you. We are front-loaded about this upcoming attack in many ways. Here is an example from a movie called The Day After Tomorrow. Putting the bill and movie clip next to each other, you can see they are front-loading the same agenda. Looking on the next image hidden on the same $100 bill, you can see a nuclear missile impacting the water. The watermark layers of ink show the water splashing from the impact of the nuke. Laid on top of the bill is a missile strike and how it would look to show you the resemblance between the two. Finally, let's look at the new $10 bill and review the exact same agenda hidden on it.
Out of the sea shall come fire and smoke and a devouring wind. $100 bill. Water as high as the walls of Jerusalem. $10 bill. We'll cover the city by the sea. So I said those words in 2007, and then, whoa, look at your bills. Wow, what a coincidence. Oh, false prophet.
Notice the orange tint on the bill. This was done with intent. On the top of the image, you will see a large explosion happening while the building has a large tidal wave pouring over top of it. In the bottom portion of the image, you will see the building's reflection from the water flooding. The threats are real and should be taken seriously. For more information, links are in the description below.
Okay, so there you go, and there's the Vatican. That's a snake, you guys. Look at your screen. Just look at your whole screen. Is someone trying to tell me that's not the head of a snake wearing a crown? Is anyone out there in crazy land trying to tell me that? Now, don't forget, when I did my MMPI, the results, I needed them again, but Dina Trevino had moved offices. So I called her up and I said, hey, I need those results. And she said, you know, we lost a bunch of boxes. You'll have to take it again. I was like, what? It's a $2,000 test. I was like, I don't want to take it again. And she goes, I'll give it to you free. I'm like, that's not very encouraging either. I don't want to take it again. She said, well, that's the only way I can give it to you. I took it again, same results. Okay? So now, if I'm telling you what I'm seeing is what I'm seeing, and someone's like, oh, no, it's not, Clegg, you're a liar. Well, you're crazy, Clegg. No, you got to go take some MMPIs. We'll look at those and we'll talk. But then we'll talk spiritually. That's a snake wearing a crown. See it? Snake, eye, mouth. Isn't it weird that the sidewalk right in front of the mouth makes a split tongue? See, the people that bark the loudest, methinks thou dost protest too loudly. And you know who I'm talking to. That's it. Okay, now, let's do a room at the Heartbreak Hotel, because I think I should do it, because the night I got saved, it was the Heartbreak Hotel in a way, but I had found something better. I'd been born into eternal life, and what was going on in my life, I could have had a whole bunch of money. I could have lived the jet set life. Heck, I mean, with the kind of money that Vlad Iwer was capable of making and already proven itself, if I would have worked hard, I could have made easily 100 mil. Just working hard, just selling the glasses, selling the trademarks, making deals, whatever. But can you imagine being willing to walk away from that for the truth, for the 100%, no lying? Well, that means you got to really believe in it, right? Sure. Okay, well, most people aren't willing to do that. Now, ready? Right side up, upside down. Male is right side up, female's upside down. By the way, y'all should go get the lyrics to it. From where I stand, I can see through you. From where you're sitting, pretty one, I know they got to you. I see the stars in your eyes. You want the truth, but you need the lies. Rock and roll. Because we were on the rock, we were the stones of fire, and we got rolled. That's why there's a band called the Rolling Stones. And they have the tongue sticking out. Because we're the stones of fire, and we got rolled. That's why there's a band called the Rolling Stones. They serve Satan. That's why their logo's a tongue sticking out, just like the sheep. I mean, hello. Okay, this is a bust. Let's watch this. Then I got to take a break. By the way, when you watch it, when the girl looks outside, notice everything's backwards. Pay attention. If you have eyes to see, you should freak out on this video. If you have eyes to see, this video should blow your mind. If you don't, it won't.
fireproof.
A room at the Heartbreak Hotel. Boy, have I been there, man. So. Looks like the end's here, guys. Looks like the end is here. Looks like the time is upon us any moment. Any moment. We're at the door of nuclear war, guys. It's printed on your freaking money. It's printed on your money. I prophesied it back in 2007. I think it was 2007. Anyway, I love you guys in Christ. I've laid down my life for the good of the sheep. But I am sure getting tired of all the mouths running, I gotta admit. But the ditch that y'all dug has become your own. All of you, everyone that dug it. Everyone that dug that ditch, it's become your own ditch now. Okay? Yeah, I love you in Christ, and I do. And to all my subscribers, I want to tell you one thing. Quit taking the bait and going over to the demonically infused channel. Don't go over there and argue with them. Have some wisdom. Show a little bit of restraint. You don't go get sucked into the arguments. Don't you know that's a bait for you guys. Quit showing up. I don't need anyone to defend me over at that channel or any other channel. Please stop, or I will block you from my channel from commenting. Anyone that feels like you need to go over there and argue with those people, then you may not belong at my channel. Just stop it. Leave them alone. Pray for them. Don't get sucked in. Don't let them rent any space in your head. God have mercy on them. It's really fascinating. I know that the Gene Revel channel actually thought that I was watching his stuff. I was like, dude, sorry to disappoint you, buddy. No, I've watched a couple small segments, and I was like, okay, good for you. Sorry to see you're so badly off, and just know that the king's coming, though. So here we go. As is my little trademark thing, I like to give everybody a hug. In Christ, that's you. This is Johnny. I love you guys in Christ. Pray for Richard's children, for his kids. I've watched little kids get caught up in the crossfire of the spiritual battle, and it's awful. Pray for the children and all the people that are being disingenuous and fake and phony and lying. The Bible says, whoever lies is a child of Satan. Just remember that. You can argue with it all you want, but in the end, you can say whatever you want. The Word of God never fails, ever, ever, ever. All right. You, Johnny, I love you in Christ. Peace and grace. I think our time's here. Very close. Praise God. I'm ready. I want to go home.